Good evening. I feel like we're in church. There's plenty of room up front. So if some of you in the back want to sit down, please. There's plenty of seating here. Thanks to all for attending tonight, the second annual Michael Mizell-Nelson Lecture in Public History. My first duty, of course, is to recognize our late colleague's family, Professor Merle Mizell, who has generously endowed this lecture series. Merle, please. His daughter, Tracy Moore. Michael's wife, Kathy, and their son, Arlo. My next thank you is to President John Nicklow, who will offer some words of greetings.
Thank you, Bobby. It really is a pleasure to welcome you all to the University of New Orleans. I am so happy to have you here this evening. This, as Bobby mentioned, is the second lecture in a series funded by, graciously funded by the endowment from Dr. Merle Mizell. This type of gift really does simply allow the university to bring important speakers to campus, and I'm pleased with the attendance. Clearly, there's an interest and a demand in this kind of speaking event. This series in particular highlights the importance of public history, which is the collection and transmission of historical knowledge to a wide audience. Lots of different disciplines, lots of areas of backgrounds for us in the audience here. And that goes beyond our traditional academic publishing methods. In a city like New Orleans, where our history is so important to our identity, I'd argue that the public history has an even greater relevance and value. So what a perfect topic. And there was no greater ambassador for New Orleans public history than Michael Mizell-Nelson, who was respected and beloved by so many in our city, at our university, and beyond. And this lecture really is and continues to be a testament to Michael's enduring impact. So thanks to everyone for being here tonight. Again, welcome to the University of New Orleans, and thank you for taking part in this event, especially to Professor Walter Hawthorne. Thank you.
In addition to the lecture, which will begin in a few minutes, we use this occasion to bring our students, alums, and others up to date on departmental news. I must note a sad event a couple of months ago when we lost Jarrah Johnson, Professor Emeritus, and I've asked Professor Gunter Bischoff to say a few words about Jarrah.
Good afternoon, everyone. We got a fantastic turnout. If it were the French Quarter Festival, I'd say, how are you, New Orleans, right? President Nicklow and Provost Amusigar, it's good to see you here. And retired colleagues, students, welcome. Now, our colleague Jarrah Johnson passed away on February 12th. He was one of the founding fathers of the University of New Orleans, arriving in 1959, a year after the university opened, and had a 44-year career on this campus, retiring in 2003. Jarrah was the backbone of the history department for many years, and he also served as chair for many years in the history department. UNO, at that time when he arrived, late 50s, early 60s, was an exciting place to be for intellectuals like Jarrah Johnson, who as a car-carrying socialist invited the likes of former socialist party leader Norman Thomas to campus for a talk. Those were the times. Jarrah grew up on a plantation in southern Georgia, and he maintained the airs of a genteel southern patrician throughout his career here on campus too. He got his BA from Emory, his PhD from Chapel Hill. And in 1956-58, he went as a Fulbright professor to Paris, and apparently he spent much of his time on the left bank drinking coffee, smoking cigarette, and drinking cognacs. That's what Fulbright professors did at that time. Chera was the Renaissance and Reformation historian in the UNO History Department. But like many of us, he taught much more than his field. When I was in the MA program as a student at UNO in 1979-1980, I took a lecture course with him in Louisiana history. He easily covered the Atlantic Basin, switching back and forth between the court of Louis XIV and the swamps of Louisiana. He was a true Renaissance man, being comfortable with 15th century Florence and Venice as he was comfortable with Huey Long and Congo Square. Chera Johnson was a daunting presence in the classroom, particularly the basic historiography course that all graduate students had to take. When he retired, Coleman Warner, who at that time was with the Times-Picayune, wrote an op-ed piece and he commented, "Within months, he steered those of us who didn't drop out, the class did shrink noticeably," Coleman said, "through an astonishing volume of material about scholars and movements I heard of only superficially before. He seemed equally at ease discussing Herodotus and other chronicles of ancient Greece as he was with the new left historians of a few decades ago. His standards for long research papers rife with citations were at the time withering. He unraveled mysteries of the historian's craft for us young historians." And Coleman seized him up well in this piece, writing, quote, "An unreformed smoker, comfortable amid mounds of papers and documents in a plain corner office, Johnson cast the image of an old school prof, confident and casually dressed and often mildly aloof. To many, he seemed an odd fit for a startup urban university." And those of us who knew Chera remember him in that corner office. And there was many stories that floated around the history department, so I did a little bit of quizzing of retired colleagues, and this is what Bill Savage had to say, a story that he told. And Bill is here with us tonight. Welcome, Bill. He said, so when the College of Education building went up, it was supposed to open in 1976. It was the bicentennial year of the United States, and apparently the contractor ran out of funds after he put up at the top of the building bicen, B-I-C-E-N, and then he ran out of money. So Chera was quite upset about this, and after a few months, he went to President Homer Hitt and said, "This can't be." As Bill said, Chera was a very proper man, and Chancellor Hitt greatly valued his judgment, and he took it down again. And actually, just went over it. It's not up anymore. And this story I found interesting. Nick Bueller told me the story. He said in 1970, they went to the Southern meeting in Houston, Texas, the Southern Association of Historians. And you know what they did in the evening? They went to see a fight of Cassius Clay against Sonny Liston. And apparently Chera was a big fan of Cassius Clay, Muhammad Ali, and attended as many fights as he could. And that's an aspect of him I didn't know. So Sarah will be sadly missed. Thank you.
Thanks, Gunter. Some quick bullet points about the department. Now, as many of you know, the Department of History and Philosophy. We welcome our colleagues in philosophy and have already begun work on joint projects. Congratulations to Molly Mitchell and Connie Atkinson for their work with the OAH conference and the successful opening of the States of Incarceration exhibit at the Ogden Museum, a project that was completed in partnership with the New School Humanities Action Lab. Ben Weber, who managed those students, I think is here as well. Ben? Yeah, thank you, Ben. Connie's here? Where's Connie? Hiding in the back, okay. Thank you all for that. And I'd urge all of you to get down to the Ogden and see the exhibit. It's a wonderful exhibit, and 20 universities cooperated on it, among them the UNO students. We're also pleased to announce tonight the appointment of Professor Atkinson to the position of Joseph Logsdon Professor for History Teaching. That's one of a number of endowed professorships we have. We hope to fill the Casimir Professorship for African American History and Nick Mueller Professorship for Public History in the fall. We established two awards I want to tell you about quickly. In honor of our late colleague, Jack O'Connor, we will award a scholarship for a UNO history major studying in France. This was Jack's field of expertise. We have exchange programs and, of course, a summer program in France, so one history major will receive that. And to honor an emeritus professor with an extraordinary record of service to the department and the university, we'll also be awarding the William Bill Savage Travel Scholarship to a student attending the UNO Innsbruck summer program. Indulge me for just a moment while I give you a quick story here about Bill. Bill went to Innsbruck a number of different times and was known occasionally to frequent Pub 7. It's a small cafe not far from the student dorm, and he could be found there from time to time enjoying a medicinal glass of red wine. A year or two ago, this is some years after Bill stopped attending the Innsbruck program, a colleague of mine went to this pub and mentioned UNO, and the proprietor immediately asked, "Do you know Bill?" "Yes," was the enthusiastic answer, and they traded observations about Bill for a few minutes, and at that point the proprietor said, "Why don't we call him?" taking out his cell phone on which he had stored Bill's number. So no greater devotion to Innsbruck than to have your phone number on speed dial for a local cafe. There's a lot more going on to the department. I can't end without thanking Jim McIver, Travis Wagaspack for all of the work that they've done on the Michael Mizell-Nelson Digital History Lab, which we officially opened just an hour ago. It will provide a place for our students and faculty to master the skills of digital scholarship so necessary in today's marketplace of ideas and jobs. Forgive me if I've skipped anything or anyone, but we should move to the main reason for tonight's gathering. Professor Molly Mitchell will provide a formal introduction to tonight's speaker. After his lecture, we'll have some time for questions and answers, and then a reception. And those of you that are standing in the back, please come sit down. There's plenty of seats up here. Please come sit down. There's plenty. This feels like a class. Nobody's listening. Molly?
Good evening. So it's my pleasure to introduce tonight's speaker, Professor Walter Hawthorne. Professor Hawthorne is professor of history at Michigan State University and is currently chair of the department there. Professor Hawthorne is also a key researcher affiliated with MSU's Matrix Center for Digital Humanities and Social Sciences. He received his PhD from Stanford University in 1998 and taught at Mills College, University of Vermont, and Ohio University before his arrival at MSU. He's the author of two books, Planting Rice and Harvesting Slaves, Transformations Along the Guinea-Bissau Coast, 1450 to 1850, published in 2003, and From Africa to Brazil, Culture, Identity, and an Atlantic Slave Trade, 1600 to 1830, published by Cambridge University Press in 2010. And he also has articles published in the American Historical Review, Slavery and Abolition, and the Journal of African History, among others. He has received numerous grants and fellowships from the National Endowment for the Humanities and was the recipient of a Fulbright-Hays Faculty Research Fellowship in 2005 for research in Guinea-Bissau, Portugal, and Brazil. I first met Walter at a very early morning breakfast meeting at an American Historical Association a few years ago. I can't even remember what city we were in. But it was a gathering of scholars who had long been engaged in using digital tools to produce new histories of slavery in the Atlantic world. Though I knew some of these scholars already, it was still a bit intimidating to be drinking coffee with pioneers in this field. It was at that meeting that I first heard Walter talk with great enthusiasm about the digital lab he was building at Michigan State. Through an innovative partnership with the Department of Anthropology at MSU, He helped establish the Lab for the Education and Advancement in Digital Research, or LEADER, its acronym. I think it's on his computer right here on the sticker. It is a model for liberal arts departments seeking to introduce their graduate and undergraduate students to the practice of digital humanities. I know it has been influential in the development of the Michael Mizell-Nelson Lab dedicated earlier today. At LEADER, students learn to work in innovative ways with primary research material, including data management, data mining, creating 3D models of artifacts. They learn how to produce projects aimed at a broad public, and most important perhaps, they learn that they must work together to accomplish their goals. Researching and publishing histories and documents related to the Atlantic slave trade has long been a collaborative enterprise, perhaps because those of us interested in retrieving the lives of individual enslaved people from the leavings of the past really need one another in order to recover people who were for far too long assumed to be irretrievable from history. Dr. Ibrahim Asek, who I think is here with us tonight, is he here? No, not yet. Can certainly attest to this. For instance, with Gwendolyn Midlow Hall, whose Louisiana Slave Database was a pioneering effort to collect and analyze documents on enslaved people in this state, Professor Hawthorne launched Slave Biographies Atlantic Database Network, a digital repository of data sets from throughout the Atlantic, funded by a large grant from the NEH. Such a project is possible only through collaboration with multiple scholars in the field who contribute their work for use by other researchers and for the public. So I'll close by saying that I'm so glad to have Walter Hawthorne here for the second annual Michael Mizell-Nelson Lecture, not only because I like him, but also because his work and career are emblematic of the collaborative work ethic that was so central to Michael's teaching and scholarship. Professor Hawthorne's talk is entitled New Directions in Digital Public History, Africa and the Atlantic World.
Thank you, Molly. Good evening. It's an honor to be invited to speak at the University of New Orleans for the Michael Mizell-Nelson Lecture. Thank you to Robert, Jim, Molly, and everybody who invited me. I had the honor today to tour the Michael Mizell-Nelson Digital Teaching Lab. In a word, it's spectacular, and I hope everybody here can make their way over there eventually to look at it. The lab is a testament, I think, to Michael's vision as a researcher and teacher, and to his dedication to digital public history. In keeping with Michael's vision, my talk today is wide-ranging and explores the growing place of digital research and digital publishing in the profession of history. I myself am an historian of Africa, as Molly has told you, whose research focuses on slavery and the Atlantic slave trade. I intend to talk for the most part, not exclusively, but for the most part about what I know best, and that's digital scholarship on these topics. Now, as I sat in my office thinking about what to say in this public lecture, I revisited some of Michael's work on the internet. This line that you see on the screen from one of Michael's 2012 essays spoke to me, and I'll read it. Quote, "My glimpse of the new media revolution came in 1995. At the same time I was reading this essay by Michael, I was listening, believe it or not, to the Beatles on my computer and White Album, track 25. Anybody? Revolution. What I want to talk about today is indeed what Michael characterized, and I am sure he was quite right, as a revolution in the profession of historical research, writing, and teaching. But first, let me talk a little bit about the White Album. When I was a kid, my best friend's older sister, April, got a hold of this. She was very hip, and I had a crush on her, so eventually I went out and bought it myself. My first album. I bet none of you can say you had a first album that was this cool. Now, some of you in the audience may have owned one of these things. Others in the audience may have heard of them. This is vinyl, and it's played on a turntable. 2 years after its release, the White Album showed up in the car of the dad of a kid who lived in the rich neighborhood up the road. It was in the form of an 8-track, and that's what this is. Only a few of you know what that is. And then shortly thereafter came this, the cassette tape. And the unlucky few who had purchased the 8-track never ever played it again. Now, I never bought the 8-track and I never bought the cassette, but I did record my vinyl copy of the White Album onto cassettes, and I would trade them to other people for recordings they had made of albums. Then, in the mid-1980s, everything changed. CDs. I do own the CD version of the White Album. It is in a box in my basement. We have basements in Michigan. With about 200 other CDs, and it's between a box marked vinyl and another marked mixed tapes. And today, my point, there was a revolution in the music industry. We can now listen to music in digital form anywhere and everywhere we are. And if I get too boring, you can put your earbuds in and start listening to music right now. So, how has the output of my profession, the profession of many of you, history that is, changed over time? This is a scriptorium. And 1,000 years ago, this is where books were produced in Europe. You can see them there, handwritten in the background. Of course, the advent of the printing press revolutionized bookmaking. The product books came out in greater volume, but was more or less the same. And it was the book that historians wrote. To be sure, modern bookmaking is much different. Increased volume, decreased cost, except, of course, for academic books, most of which cost a small fortune. This is my latest academic book on the screen, $39.99 on Amazon. To be sure, we have today ebooks, but for the most part, the product of my profession, history, is not all that different from what it was 1,000 years ago. Pages in a binding start at the beginning and read through to the end. I am not here, I assure you, I am not here to cast aspersions upon the book. I am very proud of the ones I've written, but I am convinced, as was Michael, that history departments must be big tents, and that digital public history projects should not be seen as what Michael dubbed lanyap, a word we don't use much in Michigan. It of course means add-ons, or something that stands beside is added to something. Indeed, digital public history projects will, if they aren't already, and I think they are, establish a place beside books in the hierarchy of what we as professional historians value. Now, a warning before I continue. I am a historian. I am good at reading the past, but only a little bit better than an economist at forecasting the future. Any economist in the room? I hope so. Nonetheless, I will do some predicting here today. I will argue that a revolution has come to our profession as it did to the music industry, and it has come and will continue to come whether you want it to or not. What is that revolution? Let's call it the digital public history revolution. In brief, it involves one or both of the following. First, the application of digital tools to historical research, and second, the publication of historical work on the internet. What does digital public history offer? It offers new ways for historians to, I think, do four things that I break down here in very simple terms. First, preserve historical material and make them widely available. Second, analyze sources and conduct research. Third, publish research findings and reach and influence, I think influence is important, diverse audiences. and finally energize the classroom and provide students with a range of transferable skills. Let's start with preservation and access, the first step, I think, in many digital projects, and certainly we as historians rely on sources, right? That's what we do. We rely on primary sources for our research. So preserving and accessing them is important. Certainly you are familiar with this. This is Google Books, of course. It is the best example, I think, of an access project. Right at your fingertips are 25 million of what is estimated to be about 130 million distinct book titles that exist in the world today. But 99% of the material on this site, and I could put up some other sites, JSTOR is another perfect example. Some of you scholars use JSTOR, gives you access to scholarly articles. Most of this material, most JSTOR material, isn't in danger. That is, most of these books are preserved somewhere in hard copy form in libraries. What digital historians, and I'll add digital librarians, have been interested in is preserving primary source material, original records, that are in danger of disappearing because of neglect or simply a lack of resources. And to be sure, some places, many places, where the primary sources that I am interested in, I as a historian of slavery and the Atlantic slave trade, are in danger because of inhospitable climates and political and economic conditions that are not favorable to archives. Now, this is not gonna work, I think, but let me talk briefly, and I'm gonna show you a video. I don't think the sound will work, but I'll talk through what's going on. Let me show you a video of a project that I was involved with in partnership with Matrix. Now, Matrix is our digital humanities and social science research center at Michigan State University, and Dean Rayberger, who is the director of that, is here with me today. If you have any questions afterwards, Dean is a terrific person to talk to. This project that I will show you a brief video on took place in the Gambia, and it took place with funding from the British Library, which has a terrific project, endangered archive project, to preserve records, historical records that are somewhere in the world, they prefer pre-modern records, and are in danger of disappearing. So at the time, a few years ago, I had a graduate student, Bala Saho, who came up with an idea. He's from the Gambia. He knew of the archives in the Gambia, harsh climate, lots of insects, not much money for archives, had some terrific records for 19th century and early 20th century, partly dealing with the slave trade, partly dealing with some Muslim or Qadi courts that had been established in the early colonial period. And he said, let's apply for a grant and let's preserve these things. Now, the beauty of the project that we engaged with was it was country-centered. It was archive-centered. We actually went to the Gambia, sat down with archivists, and they were full-on partners with us. And all we did, Matrix and myself in the history department, is we went over with my graduate student, we gave 2 weeks of training, we left equipment, and Gambians themselves carried out the project. Now again, I don't think the sound will work here, but I think you'll get a little bit of a sense if it comes on. Whoops, went too far. Here. It's not working. So these are some of the records that, this is actually a video that was made, sorry there's no sound, a video that was made by the local news channel, and these are some of the records. I mentioned that we engaged in a training process. We bought over digital equipment, we bought over computer equipment, we bought over laptops, desktops for storing records, and we went through this training project, again, involving local Gambian archivists. Who are today carrying out this project. They're continuing with the project. This is my student Bala, who came to me with the project. He is now a professor of African history at the University of Oklahoma. So again, the importance, I think, of this project is that it is a partnership with local people in the Gambia. We sat down together, wrote the grant together, brought equipment, performed training, and they are carrying out digitization of these rare documents, preserving them in digital form. Now, another terrific preservation and access project is this one right here. I give you the URL below, but this is called Ecclesiastical and Secular Sources for Slave Societies. And it is spearheaded by Jane Landers at Vanderbilt University. I encourage you to pull it up on your computers and look at it. I would do the same, but a good friend of mine once warned me, never get on stage with live animals or live internet. This project is aimed at preserving, as you can see, sources, ecclesiastical and secular sources for slave societies. And what Jane and her partners around the world do, particularly in Cuba and Brazil, also Venezuela, she's starting to branch out, she was in Cape Verde recently, is digitize sources that are stored in churches and other locations, and as you can see from this image and this one, are decaying rapidly. A lot of these are baptismal sources and marriage sources, and interestingly, they mention the names of slaves and who they married. And with baptismal records, who parents are, who children are, who the godparents are. Fantastic sources that, again, we as historians have an obligation to preserve and an obligation to make available for future generations. She's got, I think, 10,000, over 10,000, 10, 20, 30,000 images that she's made, all available on that site. Now, I could go on and on and on about other projects, and there are a lot of them that fall into this preservation and access category. I'm not going to talk about too many of them because I would run out of time. This, however, is one other project. I focus on a couple of documentary projects focused on documents. This is a project being carried out by a company called Trimble. Dean Rayberger from Matrix and I were out in Colorado recently talking with them about a partnership. But what Trimble Corporation on their own has been doing is creating 3D images of slave structures, structures associated with slavery in the Atlantic slave trade. And you can see here a project that they did imaging slave cabins. They're doing this all over the United States, and we're talking to them right now about imaging some slave castles in Africa and creating a website where folks who don't have the resources to go to Africa could actually tour some of these sites in 3D version right on their website. Now, this is important for preservation, I think particularly in Africa where some of these slave castles, particularly the one I'm most interested in, the Gambia, are in risk of deteriorating. But I think it's also important for educational purposes. People can actually see these things and experience these things. So again, archival preservation and access projects that look at documents and preservation and access projects that look at physical structures. Next, let me briefly talk about how some historians are analyzing sources and conducting research in the digital age. That is analyzing sources and conducting research, something different from preservation and access. It is one thing, of course, to preserve records, but historians, of course, must do much more. We ask and answer questions about the past. Now, this section of my paper, like the last, could go on for hours, so I will focus on only a few things. And most of these things could be put under the category of what I call databasing, and my research collaborators at Matrix call structuring data, which is putting the stuff of history in the form which, in which one can, with the aid of computer programs, make sense of, draw conclusions from. Now, my favorite database tool, favorite database project, favorite database platform for historical analysis, this is this one. Now, some of you interested in slavery and the Atlantic slave trade are probably familiar with it. If you're not, this is called Voyages, the Atlantic Slave Trade Database. It contains structured data about over 36,000 slave ship voyages. On the site, users can examine individual slave ship voyages and get estimates for the size of the trade from individual ports, regions of Africa, and the whole of Africa. On the American side, one can generate statistical data about ports, regions, and the whole of North and South America. It is a fantastic tool. It is a fantastic research tool. Again, individual ships. You can trace flows of enslaved Africans from particular ports to particular ports. You can pull up a port in North America, right here, New Orleans, and you can see over time where ships that brought enslaved Africans to New Orleans came. Now, this is important because no longer do we have to talk about Africans coming to the Americas. We can talk about people from particular places, particular regions of Africa, and we can begin then to explore their cultures, the cultural assumptions that they brought with them to particular places. This tool has answered, and I think this is the importance of these projects for historians, that is asking and answering questions about the past. This tool then has answered many big questions about the trade. So it is once a tool for research, but it also is helping us draw conclusions. Not the least of which, these important questions are, one of the important questions, is the trade's overall size, which is something that historians have debated for decades. And this site has helped us answer that and many, many other questions. Next, slave biographies, which Bali mentioned. Now, this is a project at Michigan State University that Gwendolyn Midlow Hall, I, and many of our collaborators from across the country and at Matrix have been involved in. Slave biographies, you can see the URL there at the bottom, slavebiographies.org, contains information about over 100,000 enslaved people who labored in Maranhão, Brazil, and colonial Louisiana. And again, it is the product of the work of Gwen Hall, myself, and countless others who partnered with us. The project is at once a preservation platform. That is, Gwen's data is there, my data is there, and actually the purpose of the project. We had NEH funding for this, National Endowment for the Humanities, and I will put in a plug for you all to lobby hard for the preservation of National Endowment for the Humanities and National Endowment of the Arts in future congressional budgets. But this project, the one I just showed you, and many other projects out there about slavery and the Atlantic slave trade and many digital projects are sponsored by the NEH, so absolutely vital for us to tell history. This is at once a preservation project. Again, my data is up there, Gwen's data is up there, the data of many other people are, will be added to this, but it's also a tool for historical analysis. Whereas voyages, the site I just showed you, traces movement of ships across the Atlantic, using things like Africans' ethnonyms, Gwen and I on these sites, and you as users of the sites, can actually determine from where generally enslaved people came, that is by tracing their ethnonyms, to give us another look at the Atlantic slave trade. And I will add that this is also a tool, particularly Gwen's data, for genealogy, that is for public history, for the public to get involved and to trace their own histories. I could go on and on. I want to mention this one. This, of course, is Freedom on the Move. This beautiful site, the URL is down at the bottom, if you haven't looked at it, is the product of the labor of Ed Baptiste, Molly Mitchell from right here at UNO, and Joshua Rothman. And it is a collection of sources from runaway slave records, from which you can do many of the same things that you do with our site, that is run statistical analysis, figure out who people are, figure out how many people from particular groups, ethnic groups, or genders are in there, and draw conclusions about the slave trade. Now, one of the fascinating thing about this is it's a product, it's a project being carried out with an approach to research that is incredible, and that is crowdsourcing. That is, it in part, not exclusively, but in part relies on the public to sit down and actually look at documents that are available on the site and enter data. Now that is, again, what does the internet offer us? What does the digital age offer us? It offers these new approaches to our own research, and there are countless others that I could talk about. Now, what is the new frontier? Lastly, I want to talk very briefly about this. This is a project that we're working on at Matrix and partnering with scholars from around the world. And I think the internet is important in part because it allows us to do this. I can talk with somebody in England, in West Africa, in Cuba. Well, Cuba's a little difficult, actually, in Brazil, in real time about a project, exchange ideas, and move it forward. This is past. This is people of the Atlantic slave trade. It's still in its infancy. We're seeking funding for it. But ultimately, the idea here is to be able to link platforms, that is, link databases with information about enslaved Africans all over the world. And we're doing so by standardizing fields in these things, and then what ultimately the past hub will do, as you can see here, is link those and allow users to trace individual enslaved Africans across space and through time, and also draw meaningful statistical conclusions about slavery by, it's really a big data project by combining multiple databases and then running statistical analysis. Third and last, it also, I think, will be a terrific tool for genealogists to draw on multiple multiple websites, multiple databases in order to trace their own family histories. The site will also allow users to run data visualizations. I won't talk much about this. You can see it's a map of Virginia, and we're playing, experimenting with this wheel here where you could pull up certain characteristics that enslaved people might have, and you can see how many of them might be in certain areas. You might also be able to link their networks and see who, over time and across space, they were connected to. Now, considerations. Let's pause for a moment to consider the importance of these approaches to public history. Yes, each is preserving sources for future generations. Oops, here we go. Preserving sources for future generations. Now, I say probably, and I think this is a big issue. Now, just because it's on the internet doesn't mean it's going to be there forever, right? And I think this is something that all of us as digital historians need to think about. That is, how are we going to assure that our websites, that our digital projects are there for future generations indeed to see? And this is why we need contributions from libraries and we need contributions from higher administrators to keep these projects going. Yes, each of these projects is providing the public and researchers access to sources for the study of history. And yes, each is asking important questions about the past and answering them. But I think there are ethical considerations with the digitization and dissemination on the internet of materials from around the world. And I have here, you can see on the screen, taken from whom? That is, who has these documents that we're digitizing? Now, the projects that I have mentioned have all are all what I would call community or archive-centered and archive-controlled. That is, they are partnerships. These aren't projects where somebody from the United States marches in with an expensive digital camera, starts taking documents, and then takes them back. These are projects where local archivists, local people are consulted with and are involved, as you saw from the video clip that I showed you, are involved with the project from start to finish. Our project was simply a training project. We went to the Gambia, we brought equipment, we did some training, and it is controlled by Gambians. They've chosen to house some of the materials that they digitized at Matrix, but that's simply for us to ensure that they are there for the future. They control the project. I think this is absolutely crucial in the digital age and for these preservation projects. That is true collaborations, something digital projects have to have. And I think the other sort of word of caution here is that there are profound implications for how we as professional historians undertake our work and reach conclusions. Now, what do I mean by that? Let me show you something. This is me last week in my office doing research. This is some documents from Jane Lander's project at Vanderbilt. You can see them on my screen. I've got another computer down below. You can see how messy I am in real life. And actually, I have a sweater on and it's snowing outside. That's just last week. This is me in the 1990s and early 2000s conducting research in Guinea-Bissau. Now, I show you this to stress something I have preached since I received my PhD. We must, and particularly those of us who write about communities that are not our own, we must consider what anthropologist David Cohen called the interior past of the societies that we study. That is, we must not stand on the shorelines of the places we study and look in. We must spend time with the people who are the subjects of our studies, or the descendants of the subjects of our studies. That is, we must learn from them, and we must ask people in the communities that we write about, what is important to them about the past and why. Now, I think the internet can be a tool that links people across great distance, certainly. And the projects that I have worked on have certainly done that. We've gone to the Gambia. I still go to Guinea-Bissau and visit people. All of our projects have this community-centered focus. And I think, I'm sure, having looked at Michael's projects and having looked at what's going on in the new digital lab here, that is clearly the focus. So again, my other cautionary note, my other plea for those of you who are entering this realm of digital public history, let's use the internet, let's use these digital tools for collaboration for projects that reach broad audiences and include in them at the point of construction many people and have many voices as a part of them. Now, lastly, I want to talk briefly about digital public history's ability to energize the classroom and instill students with 21st century skills. Now, this is an image of a lecture given in Italy in the mid-14th century. I love this image because it sort of looks like my classroom today. You can see the student on the side sleeping. And had they laptops, the folks in the front here, rather than reading and not paying attention, would have their laptops open, right? And you can see some folks there in the back are chatting it up. This is a lecture hall, right? This is how, in the mid-14th century, we, as lecturers, as scholars, as historians, reached out to students. We stood, there's some irony here because I'm doing the same thing right now. But we stood at a podium and we talked to an audience that included at least one person who's paying attention and other folks who are doing a lot of things. So it's the lecture. That's how we reach students. Mid-14th century. This is a lecture hall at Michigan State University today. Not much has changed. Now, I think this is a posed picture. This isn't my picture. No one's sleeping. Not that our students sleep at MSU. But you can see the format, right? From mid-14th century and go back before that all the way up to today. How do we as historians interact with students? How do we teach students for the most part? I know some of you have flipped classrooms, you know, experiment with breaking people up in small groups and all that kind of stuff. But our approach to education, undergraduate education particularly, has not changed for hundreds of years. And you can see down here in the corner, I couldn't find an image of somebody grading a paper in the mid-14th century, but I don't think it's changed much. This, of course, is somebody marking up a paper. So what is our approach as historians to engaging with students for the most part? And you can give me some exceptions. Our approach is we stand at the podium and we lecture. We have students do some research in the library. They write a paper. We mark it up very, very diligently. We spend a lot of time marking up papers, right? We hand them to students, and I don't know about you, my students do this. Look at the grade, and the paper goes off to the side. Now, I'm not here to cast aspersions upon the essay. I still assign essays. I think essays are important. It's important for students to develop skills in written communication and in historical research and archives. That's one of the things we do very well. However, again, turning back to some of my comments about Michael Mizell-Nelson, I think we as historians need to have a big tent. And that brings us to our lab at Michigan State University and also to your new lab here. It was an honor to be at the ribbon cutting today. This is our lab. It's called LEADER, as Molly said, the Lab for Education and Advancement of Digital Research. This is actually a photo from last year. We opened it a little over 2 years ago, and we've run over 80 classes through it. And I think, I can't remember the count, over 3,000 students have engaged in research in our lab. To be sure, and I want this to be clear, because if you get on Twitter and my colleagues read that we're casting aside the lecture and we're no longer assigning essays, I'll be chased out of the department. To be sure, we at Michigan State University are still teaching undergraduate students skills in research, written communication, critical historical thinking, and the building of evidentiary-based arguments. That is what we as historians do, and we do it very well, and our students benefit from it. Now, however, we, and in your lab, you, are teaching, in addition to all of that, new 21st century skills. Skills that can make students, or can take students into any number of professions. Among the skills I think that can be taught in these labs, LEADER and the Michael Mizell Digital History Lab here at University of New Orleans, among the skills, teamwork. Now, I'm an introvert. I actually don't like talking to people all that much. I'll be quite nervous at the reception afterwards, so keep that in mind. I went into history because I like to sit in my office by myself and type things out. But the digital age forces us to do some things that we're not comfortable with and I think are important and are important to our students and our graduate students, and that is to work in a lab type setting. To recognize that we, as the professor, don't bring all of the skills that are necessary to the classroom. And sometimes our students might actually know a few things that we can call on. We might go to a lab and actually turn to an expert in the lab like you have here and ask some questions. I've got this data, I've got this these source materials, and I'd like to teach a class, a digital class that includes some of that. What can I do with it? So you turn to an expert who can help you with that. There's nothing wrong with that. The STEM disciplines, the science disciplines, have been doing that for a long time in labs, and I think these labs are important for us to do that, for us as professionals and also for our students to learn those schemes and skills in teamwork and collaboration. Collaboration, absolutely important for digital history projects. We also, are teaching digital communication skills. So you got your written skills, you got your oral skills, and now our students are learning digital communication skills, something absolutely essential in the 21st century. In our lab, we have a 3D printer. I was a little skeptical of it when we first got it, but our students are learning how to use 3D scanners, 3D printers, and actually the materials they're printing are being used in the classroom. Our students are learning how to explore history through gaming. Another, I think, important skills learned there that can be transferable to other things. We also have a drone, and we're teaching drone-based imaging, although our president has forbid us to fly the drone on campus, so it's a little problematic at present. And finally, our students are learning the importance of public-centered scholarship. That is, the products that they produce in LEADER, our lab, are not essays that are handed to me, quite sheepishly sometimes. I mark up and then I hand back and they look at the grade and put away. The products are out there on the internet. Our students are sending links to their parents, to their grandparents, to community people, and they're proud, typically. You get some bad digital projects, like eat some bad essays, but many of them are proud of what they produced. And they know that they're producing this for a broad audience. It's not just for me, it's for many people. Now, had I the time, I want to leave time for some questions. I'd walk you through the dozens, and there are dozens of projects that our students have created in LEADER. You can see the URL is history.msu.edu/LEADER, so you can, or just simply Google LEADER MSU, and you can look at some of these projects and maybe take some ideas from them for your own lab. I will talk about one. Now, this is a project called Black Inventors, and it's by somebody who was an undergraduate student a couple of years ago, DeLacy Yancey. She has graduated and is now in a museum studies MA program. And she will tell you. Actually, if you go to all the historians in the room, get the magazine Perspectives on History. DeLacy actually had a piece in this magazine. She wrote about our lab LEADER. She was so inspired by it. But this is one of DeLacy's projects. It's called Black Inventors, and DeLacy went to the professor who was teaching a class at the time, David Bailey, and wanted to do a project on black inventors. And what she told David and what she later told me was, you know, I take a lot of history classes about Africa, about African-American history, and everything's always so negative. You know, it's this heavy negative history. I want to do something positive. I'm going to either go into public education or be a museum specialist, and I want to find a way to tell my own history of my own past. And she came up with on her own this idea of spinning a project about black inventors. And it is a terrific project. It is remarkable. She actually worked in some gaming. She's got some essays up there that she wrote. Students read the essays, and then they go and test their knowledge through some really fun games. Again, you can see, actually, she has a t-shirt on here. She printed t-shirts up about her website and gave each one of us a copy. Now, I say to you that, again, DeLacy has written many essays. She reads many books. But this project, and I challenge anybody who is a digital history skeptic, this project does the stuff of history. She did research. She synthesized all that research, she wrote essays, and then she created a project that reached out to the public. It's really fantastic, and I think this is the kind of projects that I look forward to seeing coming out of your lab, and that certainly our students are producing as well. Now, I want to conclude now with two projects which do everything that I've talked about today. This, of course, is the brainchild of Michael Mizell-Nelson, collecting and preserving the stories of Katrina and Rita, and it was mentioned before I got here up here to speak. And he collaborated, of course, with many to create this wonderful website. And this is the New Orleans is New Orleans Historical, another of Michael's project, and one that continues to grow here at UNO today. Both embody everything that I discussed in my preservation, or in my presentation today. They are collaborative. They preserve and make widely available historical source material. They have a public outreach component. They value and indeed are centered on the point of view of the communities that they examine. They provide historical analyses, and they are wonderful, free, and easily accessible teaching tools. These projects are part of the revolution I have discussed in my presentation. About that revolution, Michael Mizell-Nelson wrote in 2012, I started with a quote, I'll end with this quote, and I quote, from one of his essays that's available on the internet, "I was fortunate that my department members came to value new media enough to support my pursuits. But far too many history departments continue to lack any programmatic approach for digital history." He continues, "More faculty and more students will undertake and complete digital projects once entire departments value and not merely approve of or tolerate such work," end quote. I could not agree more, and I would go a step farther. I think that the revolution that Michael helped launch is now advancing at a fast pace. It is something that we as professional historians and students of history must embrace. We are, after all, historians. We study change over time. That's the basis of history. It's time for us, profession-wide, to stop resisting change and to start shaping it. And that is precisely what is happening here at UNO, as is evidenced by the opening of the Michael Mizell-Nelson Digital History Lab. Thank you, and I'll be happy to take questions.
Thank you very much. Gunter saved me, at least partially, from total embarrassment in mentioning our new provost, who I think is still here. Provost Amuzigar? Well, I'll be totally embarrassed then. At any rate, our new provost to join us for a while too, and when you see him around campus, greet him and thank him for coming. We'll take questions now. Marvelous presentation. Thank you, Professor Hawthorne. Just raise your hand, and we have a microphone. Where? Ah, Travis is in the back with a microphone. So, questions? Yes.
Good afternoon. I'm Roseanne Adderley from Tulane University, and it's a pleasure to hear you talk as a slave trade historian and as someone who stumbles around in this digital world, and Michael was one of my guides. I had a question about the digital divide, because I know that in a lot of the popular press, there have been a lot of writing about the large areas in Africa in particular that sort of skipped over all of the many things that happened in our telecommunications in the West with the revolutions that happened with cell phones. And I wondered about both the practice of history among Africa and Africans, and this is now an international dialogue, and you've got students and colleagues that you highlighted in some of these projects. What this means for the practice of history and the teaching of history in places other than in the West, and in terms of collaboration, because Michael's quote talked about departments that have had the luxury of resources to practice history in all kinds of ways over the past 300 years, and we're now trying to be better collaborators, and I fear we may be digital bullies in leading these narratives, and can these digital tools make us better collaborators with Gambians or Cubans Argentinians or whomever?
That's a terrific question, and I mean, I agree with the I agree with the assumptions behind your question completely. I do fear this digital divide. I know of some projects where folks swoop into archives in some distant parts of the world and gobble up information with their cameras. That is not our approach. I don't think that should be the approach that we take. And it is also the case that in order to carry out these digital projects, you need certain equipment. I mean, you just have to have it. And if you don't have it, you're not going to do it, right? So that is an issue. On at the same time, there are many of us who, I wrote a book about Guinea-Bissau. I was quite diligent in bringing copies of my book to Guinea-Bissau and to putting them in the library that doesn't function particularly well. I think that this is a problem of the digital age. It's also a problem of 20 years ago when we all just wrote books and articles. How do we give people the products of our output? Now, I do think there is more promise with digital history. Now, in many parts of Africa, you could see a leap forward indeed. When I used to do my images from the 90s in Guinea-Bissau, no one had a cell phone. It was a wonderful time to do research. I disappeared for a year, completely. If I wanted to make a phone call to my parents once a month, I had to find somebody with a telephone, pay them cash, and try to find a way to call over this very scratchy line. Now when I go to Guinea-Bissau, I can pull out my cell phone and call. And folks on the street are calling everybody else. And there are internet centers everywhere. So it is possible, of course, to access the internet in many parts of the world. And it is possible for some folks, many folks, to access some of these materials. So if you're an aspiring historian in Nigeria, and you have access to broadband, you can indeed pull up slave voyages or slave biographies or Freedom on the Move or any number of projects and look at it. Now, you do need the equipment. So I do see this as an issue. We're recently hosted a visitor from Nigeria they're trying in Nigeria right now to set up a digital humanity center of their own. And I do see that as something that is promising. Now, these things, of course, aren't free. Yours wasn't free. I know it took a lot of work. I heard the word scrounging earlier by a lot of people to assemble enough dollars to make a lab here possible. And if we in the United States have to work, scrounge in order to get dollars to have a digital history lab, what are folks going to do elsewhere? Now, you mentioned Cuba. Of course, when I go to Cuba, I can't pull out my cell phone and do anything because it's not going to work. And accessing the internet in Cuba is quite difficult. So, that's a whole nother story. My hunch is that will change in the near future, and Cuban colleagues will be able to access these and other projects. One of the beauties, of course, though, of the internet, and for folks who live in many places, is that for folks who do have equipment, we can collaborate in real time. So for our projects in Brazil, for some of our projects in Africa, particularly Senegal, for some of our partners in Europe, we can get all on the line at the same time and talk to each other. So I am fearful of the digital divide. I think we need to keep that in mind as we move forward in this, in the infancy of digital history. And I think many of these are questions that we need to answer. Question down here.
I'm Liz McMahon, also from Tulane. Clearly we're invading.
I know very well. My last book was centered in Brazil, and the data that's presented on slave biographies is from Maranhão, Brazil. And there are indeed students, I've heard from them. They actually send me their theses and ask me to comment. But they're using slave biographies and they're using slave voyages. That's one example that I indeed know of students in these places who are working, undergraduate and graduate students, on projects and are using these. I haven't heard from anybody in Guinea-Bissau who's using these, but Guinea-Bissau has one university that is mostly aimed at producing folks who are going to work in the administration. So students from Guinea-Bissau, they go overseas mostly for training if they're interested in pursuing degrees in history. We actively recruit students from West Africa. You saw Bala Saho here. So, I mean, this is an example of somebody who thought of a project in the Gambia, and he carried it out. He came to Dean Rayberger and myself and said, let's do this. We helped him write the grant. We went to the Gambia and got their advice, and that is a Gambian project. They have digitized Gambian archives, and folks in the Gambia are using those materials. And they were very, very clear. We're not going to digitize all our stuff and put copies in Britain. We'll put some copies in Britain. We'll let folks in Britain look at them. But, you know, these are our documents. And if you want to see them, you got to come here. And that's their project. It's their stuff. That's the way it should take place. So, I mean, for me, that's, again, the promise of this. There are some problems with internet access. But these projects do offer the possibility of international collaborations. They offer the possibility of folks in Brazil. I mean, I felt an obligation to folks in Maranhão. I collected all this information about the place to make my database available, and indeed it's being used. Other questions? Molly. You are indeed right. This is Jane Lander's project at Vanderbilt right here again, and what she's doing is going all over the world with funding from NEH and from the Endangered British Endangered Library, Endangered Archive Project, and digitizing documents and preserving them. And the story, if you can ever hear Jane talk, the stories are just crazy. I mean, she goes into these little parishes, and they've got documents in Cuba that date back hundreds of years. Baptismal records from Africans who got off of slave ships. And there are names, there are folks they married, information about that, information about their children and their godparents. With many records from enslaved people, the name that is given in a baptism is always a Christian name. So you'll get Jorge. But frequently what would happen is for the last name, it would be the African ethnonym. So you get Jorge Balanta or Maria Mandinka. And that information, of course, is it's incredibly valuable for a historian. Because again, what this allows you to do is to figure out from where in Africa approximately people came. So no longer, as I mentioned earlier, do we talk about generalized Africans coming to Cuba, or generalized Africans, if you look at Gwendolyn Midlow Hall's database, coming to Louisiana. We can talk with these sorts of records about specifically where they came from. They came from this area that is Mandinka. They came from this area, very small area, where Balanta were. And you can then figure out who they married. Balanta married Balanta, or Balanta marrying Mandinka, or they marrying folks from Congo. I mean, there's all sorts of information that you can spin from these things. So they're fantastic, fantastic sources for historical information. But they are, as Jane will show you, these records, and I've done work in Brazil with similar records. Many of them are sitting in areas where there is no air conditioning. Sometimes their roof is bad, water's coming in, there are insects eating documents. Some of the records they can't possibly preserve because you pick them up and they turn to dust. But Jane and her crew are doing their best to preserve these things. And again, I mean, I think this is important for, selfishly for me as a professional historian here in the United States, but it is important for people of Cuban descent. It's important for Cubans to understand their own history, to understand where folks came from. We want to preserve records about slavery and the slave trade because we want to be able to tell the history of Cuba, which was overwhelmingly populated by people of African descent. Records in Europe are stored quite well. They're in archives that are heated and air-conditioned under very good conditions. But it's these unique sources, I think, that allow us to tell the history of people of color, of people of African descent, that we need to scramble right now to save, to preserve, so that ourselves and future generations of historians, both here in the U.S. and I think more importantly in Cuba, can make use of them. Gunter.
Michigan State basketball.
Yes, thank you for that plug.
But I'm also a big fan of the HNET platform.
HNET.
That brings me to my question: how is it that Michigan State, we've been talking about Mizell-Nelson being a digital pioneer, why are there so many digital pioneers at Michigan State University?
That's a great question. I'm a big fan of Izzo and the basketball team. I wish that 1% of their budget went to the history department. maybe 0.5% to digital history. We would be able to do so many great things. Michigan State University does have HNET, and HNET was partly founded. It was founded a couple of places, but it established itself firmly at Michigan State University in the 1990s. And all of you who are professional historians will know HNET. It's it started off as a list for scholars across the country to communicate with each other, so that if you were the one Africanist in North Dakota, you could find a group of Africanists to talk to all over the world. And it's been terribly successful. They've got a lot of lists now. They're web-based. That project, they question why. I think we've long had folks at Michigan State University going back to the 1990s who, for whatever reason, I don't like to talk about chance, it's chance, I think, happened to find themselves at Michigan State University and started carrying out digital humanities in the 1990s. And indeed, Michael Mizell-Nelson talked about the 1990s. I remember the 1990s when this revolution began, and that's when the revolution began. Michigan State University was one of those places. It started with HNET. And from HNET spun out Matrix. Matrix and HNET were one, and they spun off to separate budget lines and really have separate purposes. HNET is a digital scholarly community. Matrix is a digital history lab. We have been blessed with a higher administration that has seen the importance of this, and I'm happy that you have a higher administration here. If the provost and president are here, thank you. Keep supporting digital history. Keep supporting the humanities. If you're not here, watch the video. But we happen to have an administration that's been supportive, and we've had, since the 1990s, a number of scholars that have been entrepreneurial. And I mean, part of this involves support from administration. Part of this involves folks who are entrepreneurial and going out and getting grants and finding private money, finding donors like you have here who see this coming revolution and want to help the university be at the cutting edge of this. So it's chance and a lot of hard work.
Hi, I'm Elizabeth Manley from Xavier. And I have a question. I'm wondering if you could speak a little bit to departments or divisions or groups of faculty that might be willing and interested in starting digital humanities projects, but are perhaps lacking in resources, specifically time and money. to get these things started. And you know has this great example of Michael who, you know, kind of did this of his own passion and got things started, and it's great when that happens in that way. But are there other models to help, groups or, again, divisions or departments to kind of push forward an agenda in digital humanities, digital history?
Well, that's a terrific question, and I would say a couple of things. First of all, for individuals who are interested in developing skill sets and learning more, there are places to go. There are camps, DH camps that happen across the United States, and they're relatively low cost, and you can indeed sign up for some of these things and attend for a few days and begin to learn skills, begin to make connections. Those are terrific. We run some of those. Some of the folks who run our lab go to those. Dean does some of that. So I think there are ways. The American Historical Association, the OAH, African Studies Associations, various associations have panels on how to run DH projects now. The AHA, a couple of years ago, I organized a bunch of panels on this, and some other folks did. So there's ongoing training at some of these professional organizations. But I think you are right in that one thing you need to do these, well, you need a few things. You need the skill, and you need to begin to develop those skills. I think you partly need money. You certainly need money to carry out a big project. One of the beauties of MSU, and I see this beginning to happen here, is one of the things that helps a lot is to have a lab environment. And at MSU, we have Matrix, which is our digital research center, and we have LEADER, which is right in the history department. So any of our faculty or students who are interested in DH, it's right there. You walk in the door, and there's somebody you can talk to, somebody you can ask questions of. I myself don't know anything about code. My 10-year-old son knows more about coding than I do. That's not what I do. I rely on others for that. I know how to use WordPress and set up a website, but I'm not great at it. Some of it involves developing some of these skills yourself, and some of it involves relying on others. And I think there's great hope here in having a lab with some experts in it, some graduate students, and somebody who's actually assigned to the lab to indeed help faculty along. So what we do at Michigan State University is there's not a whole lot of money. We have to get money from the outside. What I will typically do for my DH projects is go to Matrix and sit down with Dean and other folks who work there and say, hey, I've got this idea. I've got this, you know, I was in Maranhão, Brazil, of all places, and I put together this database, and I would like to make it available to the public. What can we do? And they begin to talk about some possibilities, and then comes the next step, which is grant writing. You know, let's put in for $300,000 from the NEH, and let's try to get the money then to come in, and you know, once we have the money, we've got the lab, we can hire some programmers. So I think a lot of it is that those first couple of steps of coming up with the idea, bouncing it around, and that could involve a collaboration with another place, and then putting in a grant. And I've never gotten an NEH on the first time. I've sometimes gotten them on the second time. So I think that's the key, and then you just keep your fingers crossed and move forward. Now, the other thing you can do, of course, if you have a lab, is to begin to teach these skills to students, and I think that's something else one can do. You come up with a project that's your own research project, the bar is a little lower for teaching. The other thing that I would like to address with this question is, so you need the time. You probably need some money in order to carry off a big project, but the other thing that is important is to have a department that sees digital projects as scholarship, and as scholarship that is on par with writing articles and writing books. Because if you get the time and if you get the money and you create a project and somebody says, oh, that's nice, but your annual performance review is going to suffer because it's not a book or an article, then there's not much. Then you're not going to spend much time doing it. So I think it's absolutely necessary for every history department in the country to consider digital history and how we evaluate that annually and how we evaluate that for tenure and promotion purposes. Because this is history in the same way that writing a book and writing an article is. It still involves doing primary research. It still involves historical analyses. It's just that the result isn't necessarily a book. It could be a book and it could be a digital project, but that's not necessarily the case. So again, I think it's absolutely imperative once you have a lab and once you have people engaging in this work to think about how that work will be recognized.
You've been answering a lot of questions from faculty, and I'd like you to address a couple of things to students.
Okay.
If the students in here are interested but don't want to wait around until they're in a class where somebody is blundering through it for the first time, what should they do? What advice do you give to students to get involved in this?
Well, my advice to students here would be to, and I hope I'm not overstepping, I'm a visitor, but my advice to you would be to barge into the Michael Mizell-Nelson Digital History Lab and to say, hey, here I am, I want to do X, Y, and Z. And my hunch is you'll get a very warm reception. That's what folks do at Michigan State University. They come to the lab. Many of those students are in a class and they come to the lab for that purpose, but we have students who are interested in these projects and they look in the lab kind of sheepishly and eventually they find their way in. So go to the lab and start doing this. I mean, the interesting thing about when we first launched this crazy experiment called Leader, my assumption was students would show up and know exactly what to do, and they know exactly how to make websites, and they know they'd know more about it than me. But I'm not casting dispersions on students. But what I have discovered is that is not the case. Our students at MSU spend a lot of time on the internet. But they don't necessarily think about how to create a website and how to create a website that will be designed, laid out in a way that is user-friendly and present information to the public in a way where the public can navigate through it. I think all of you students out there, I mean, this is something, you're on the internet all the time, you're on your cell phones all the time, you know, take the next step. Learn how to do some of these things and learn how to use these tools, the internet tools that you're engaged with every day of your life, and learn how to create some of your own projects. I think it opens up, again, all sorts of doors for, this is the future. So it will open up all sorts of doors for you.
Take one more back here. Travis, can you bring
the mic? Thanks. It's been referenced here a few times, and I know Dr. Adderley brought it up on digital divide, but what about a change in administration, as in public? You know, we just had a public change in administration in Washington and allow public websites and the data on them disappeared. And I might add, I experienced the same here in Louisiana when we had a change in administration and I lost data from the very entity that I thought I was going to be up there forever. And I guess what I'm wondering is, if stuff is already made public and presented as public and it's then censored, what maybe can bodies like yours or advocates like you can do to raise this up as an issue?
I mentioned this here, that we are preserving information for future generations, probably. And this is part of the probably. Part of what happens with the disappearing of data is that folks simply lose interest in it. And you've got to keep your website up. You got to keep the server running. You got to have it interact with the latest version of Safari or Internet Explorer or whatever platform you're using in order for this thing to function. One of my fears going forward with digital history projects and other projects is that, I mean, they're not books. They don't just put them on the library and shelf and they stay there. So this is something else that I think is important for universities, important function for universities is preservation. We happen to be blessed with a center called Matrix, which is quite well funded right now. I think it'll be funded for the next 10 years. I hope it's funded for the next 20 years. But yes, indeed, this is an issue. And then we get a change in an administration, and as you said, things start disappearing. So the long-term preservation of data is an important question for us all to think about as we put our materials online and as we assume that they will be there. I don't have the answer to all of to those questions other than lobby, and make sure that we have a free and open internet and that information is not censored and it's preserved.
Let me thank Professor Hawthorne again. I want to thank everybody for coming. Put some refreshments in the back. Please help yourself. And if you're able to grab the speaker and ask a question you can get a chance to, please feel free. Okay. Thank you all again.
This is wonderful. Thank you.
Exactly
thank you.
What we wanted.
Oh, good.
Perfect
thank you.
For the audience.
It was fun.
And